Okay, it's about time for us to get started. Before we get too deep into this, I wanted to just let everyone know I am video and sound recording, so if your face is on a wanted poster somewhere, you probably don't want to come up here in front of the audience. I want to make sure everyone had that public safety announcement. My name is Tom Schaunt. I'm going to be talking about what electromagnetics can tell us about quantum mechanics. I'll dispense with the personal introduction because there's some segments that are a little autobiographical. So I'll get to who I am and what my expertise is in this area. So I'll start by talking a little bit about quantum mechanics, then about how electromagnetics or how radiation works, how constructive and destructive interference between waves work, what I call the great circle of electromagnetism, how waves interact, a very important fundamental principle of quantum mechanics, the correspondence principle, and I'll talk about why quantum mechanics needs to be fixed and how. So if you're going to talk about quantum mechanics, a really good place to start is right here at the two-slit experiment. Now, Richard Feynman said this is a phenomenon which is impossible, absolutely impossible, to explain in any classical way, and which has in it a heart of quantum mechanics. In reality, it contains the only mystery. Now, Thomas Young is the guy who noticed this phenomenology of two-slit interference. You shine a light on the two slits, and you get this interference pattern. And once people started having the ability to measure individual photons at a time, they repeated this, and they decreased the amplitude, decreased the intensity some more, until you could say with a statistical certainty you had only one photon moving through the system at a time. And when that happens, nevertheless, you still see this interference pattern, even though you know it's got to be only one photon traversing the two slits. So the question is, well, which slit does it go through? If you say try to close one to prove that it goes through the other, you destroy the interference pattern. Only if you have both slits open and somehow the photon is simultaneously in both slits at the same time does this seem to work. And that is the mystery that Feynman argues cannot be explained in any classical way. So there are two slits. There are at least three, if not more, interpretations of what's going on. First, the Copenhagen interpretation, which is the most popular. That's the idea that the quantum waveform expresses the probability. It collapses to a particular concrete instance upon detection or observation. There's the many-worlds principle. That's the theory that all the possible paths, all the possible outcomes really did happen. We just happen to be in a universe where that particular one happened. So when you flip a coin, you just create a brand new universe. And until you look at the coin, though, you don't know whether you're in the heads or tails universe. And finally, there's a theory called the pilot wave theory, that there is a definite intermediate state at all times. So how does it play out for two slits? In the Copenhagen interpretation, the photon simultaneously takes all possible paths. It goes to the top slit and to the bottom slit. It goes in each one of those interference lobes. It's all over the place, sort of smeared out. And only on the active measurement does it collapse into one of those interference bands that we see and arrive at the screen. In the many worlds interpretation, there are many photons, and some of them go through the top slit, and some go through the bottom slit, and they all end up smeared across the interference pattern, and when we make the measurement, bam! Now we're in that one universe where the photon ends up over there. Now, the pilot wave interpretation is kind of interesting. In the pilot wave interpretation, it's not just a photon, there's also a wave involved. So there's a wave that propagates through both slits. The wave interferes with itself, generating the interference pattern, and that serves to guide the photon along a particular discrete path to the screen. Now, of course, the interpretation that's most common in physics is the shut up and calculate interpretation. We got the math, who cares what's really happening or what's really going on? Let's just solve some physics problems here. So, step back and talk a little bit about the pilot wave concept. Louis deBroglie came up with this, and his argument, he presented this at the 1927 Solvay conference, that the corpuscle or photon, they hadn't quite assigned gotten that name yet, is piloted by the waves. And that's how he came up with this argument. Now, the problem with this approach is a very famous mathematician named John von Neumann very quickly was able to prove that the theory was just logically untenable. He had a very elaborate mathematical proof of that, and the prevailing founding fathers, particularly Heisenberg and Bohr, were aghast at this theory. They liked the probabilistic statistical approach, and the pilot wave theory kind of vanished into the ether. Now, fast forward about 20 years, and Richard Feynman, we just saw, his PhD advisor, a guy named John Wheeler, hired a new physics professor for Princeton University, a man named David Bohm. David Bohm wrote a very good book on quantum mechanics, and he accepted and explained the Copenhagen interpretation of this book. And then he started thinking about it, and it really started bothering him. And the more he looked into it, the more he decided that deBroglie had to be right. And it turned out von Neumann's mathematical proof had an error in it. It didn't really disprove the whole pilot wave concept. Well, unfortunately for Bohm, he had some communist sympathies in the 1950s. That was not good for maintaining a professorship. He ended up fleeing to Brazil and took a position there. But in the meantime, J. Robert Oppenheimer, the guy who directed the Manhattan Project to build the atomic bomb, directed or had a symposium at Princeton to discuss this idea, which they regarded as juvenile delinquency. And they gathered together the finest minds they could to explain and probe what's wrong with this whole pilot wave approach. One of the attendees at that conference said that after a full day of really not getting anywhere, being able to put a stake in the heart of it, Oppenheimer said, "Well, if we can't disprove it, we'll just have to agree to ignore it." And that's actually, and that is more or less what happened for another couple of decades, and it wasn't until this gentleman, a guy named John Stuart Bell, started exploring some of the fundamental principles of quantum mechanics, and pointed out that while the founding fathers were arguing over particles and waves, deBroglie proposed the obvious answer, particles and waves, so that it's two separate entities. In the 1970s, there was a lot of work done showing how if you take those two slits and calculate, even using classical electromagnetics, you find energy flow trajectories that match those specific concrete paths. Well, that brings us to the early 1990s, where a very callow and shockingly young me had the great good fortune to have John Wheeler on my doctoral committee. He was retired, emeritus, fortunately had a lot of time on his hands and loved talking with people. And I exploited that shamelessly. And one of the things that I asked him about was this idea of quantum mechanics and how does it work. And he assured me that, as a senior emeritus professor, didn't have to worry about his reputation. He was willing to explore any idea, however crazy, and he came up with some crazy ideas, if you ever look into it from bits and a few of the other concepts he played around with. But, he would go to any length to answer the question, how come with quantum? Well, a few days later, I had been studying into it and came across pilot waves and Bohm and deBroglie, and so I asked him, what do you think of this pilot wave approach? And he said, the screwdriver theory of quantum mechanics. And I kind of got what he probably meant, that it's an arbitrary mechanical construct that's putting epicycles on the system that don't have to be there to solve the math and so forth. So I asked him, well, can you tell me more? I mean, have you analyzed this? Is there a paper I can go to? Where can I learn more about your opinion here? He said, I never really looked into that, and I really should so I can find out what's wrong with it. So many of even the most brilliant, and I have enormous respect for Wheeler. You know, he was one of the leading quantum measurement physicists, in a sense, kind of Bohr's heir. He worked with Bohr in Copenhagen. But even Wheeler hadn't really looked into it to rigorously test and understand why it was working. Well, if Wheeler didn't understand it, I wasn't going to try. So I decided to do electromagnetics instead. And I had asked my advisor, or the chairman of my committee, another very brilliant physicist named George Sidarshan, about, you know, should I look at general relativity? That fascinated me. And how does energy flow through space-time? And he said, well, if you want to understand energy, start with electromagnetics, because we still don't understand that. So I did. And the particular problem I chose to solve is, we know how electromagnetic energy works when it's propagating through free space. But how does it change from being in a bound or reactive state and somehow transform into energy that's moving at the speed of light? And you know, that's the question that I've been following throughout my professional career. This was my starting point. I started with something called a dipole, the simplest possible source of radiation. Now, normally you can take these equal and opposite charges and have them oscillate sinusoidally back and forth and generate radio waves of that particular frequency. But I wanted to look at a time domain case with a definite start and a definite end. So if we assume we have a capacitor that's charged up, that's like this dipole source, and we put a resistor across it. If you study basic electronics, you know that's an exponential decay. You're going to have the charge decrease with the time constant that's equal to the product of the capacitance and the resistance. And similarly, you have a current that's acting over the link there, and it's also decreasing exponentially. Something kind of interesting, you know, if the current is going down, you have a magnetic field, right-hand rule, that's looping around the current this way. But the acceleration of the current is also a source of the radiation component of the magnetic field. And that, I dot, go in the opposite direction. It's slowing down the current as as it takes. So the magnetic fields due to the radiation, they're spinning about in the opposite direction. So the current magnetic fields are strong up close. The radiation, the I dot magnetic fields, are strong further away. It turns out there is a magic distance. And that distance is equal to the speed of light times tau, the time constant. And at that magic distance, the magnetic field is zero, because those fields are equal and opposite on that bubble around the dipole. So if you look at the snapshots of the decay, we start with this charged dipole, and we start to let it decay. And you can see the start of the decay beginning to ripple out through the fields here. We continue three-quarters of the way. Right at this point, it hits that magnetic field equals zero bubble. And you can see the fields completely decouple around the dipole. And they decouple, and those outside fields detach and move away. And what's really interesting about this is when you do a detailed calculation, you ask, how much energy was in this radiation that came from the dipole? It is exactly equal to the amount of energy that was in the static fields of the original dipole before. So in other words, the radiation from that exponentially decaying dipole, it doesn't come from, you know, popping out of point charges that are accelerating at the origin and moving away. It comes from energy that was originally stored outside that sphere. Now, I thought that was really fascinating. I guess my thesis thought for my committee thought it was good enough to give me my degree. And I really kind of put that aside and started applying my electromagnetics background on practical matters. I started off designing ultra-wideband antennas. I did some of the first commercial ultra-wideband antennas. I wrote a book on ultra-wideband antennas. I got interested in near-field physics. I found some really cool things like how close to a source, the electric and magnetic fields are 90 degrees out of phase with each other. As you move further away, they converge, and you can actually look at the difference between the phases. I was enjoying that Texas grid talk, because you're talking about reactive energy. You get the same thing in fields. You have a 90-degree reactive phase difference close to the source. They're in phase, far away, transferring real power as you get further out. And it turns out there's a really nice formula that lets you calculate distance off this phenomenon. This and some other things, taking the Friis antenna propagation laws and propagating them into the near field. They were designed to handle far field, you know, many wavelengths, long lengths. I figured out how to use them within a wavelength or so. And you pick up a third polarization. You have a radial polarization when you're in the near field. Normally you just have vertical and horizontal two polarization. It's all kinds of cool near field things. And co-founded a company called Two-Track to commercialize this. So we could go and take a map and go around to different points. We have three receivers here. We sample the field at each one of those blue points. We interpolate between. There are three antennas in each receiver. We get three amplitude services, three phase different services. And from all that data, we can then look at the live data coming in as you're walking around and tell exactly where you are and plot a track. So cool technology. Unfortunately, even though it's pretty much to this day still the most accurate indoor location technology, at least for non-line of sight cases, commercial success is a little elusive. Fortunately, my company, Two-Track, was acquired by Geeks and Nerds Corporation. I kind of came along as part of the deal. So now I have the coolest business card I've ever had in my life. My official job title is the principal scientist of Geeks and Nerds. So again,
all the old game.
I'm sorry?
That's a basic win, right?
So, anyway, as I was rewriting my antenna book, I want to go back and explain very clearly and simply how electromagnetic waves work. And you have to realize an electromagnetic wave is two waves in one. It's an electric wave, like this one you see over here. And, you know, the electric fields form closed loops. Normally, we sort of ignore that, and we just look at what's happening on axis. The magnetic fields, they also form closed loops. In this case, circling around the origin. This is a special kind of wave called a transverse magnetic wave. We don't need to get into that. But in any event, an electromagnetic wave is an electric wave and a magnetic wave acting at right angles to each other. They have equal energy, and this is something people don't always appreciate. That energy is proportional to the intensity of the electric or magnetic field squared. Of course, the fields are at right angles to each other, and they end up propagating in a direction that is at right angles to both fields. So you end up, that gives rise to something called a pointing vector that describes what direction the field goes in. So you use your right-hand rule and look at your electric field, your magnetic field, and work out the pointing vector to know where that field is going. So I asked myself, let's simplify this a little bit, look at a simple wave. How does a constructive interference work? So we have this little infinitesimal wave coming this way, we have this wave going that way, we have unit amplitude, say, and unit energies to make the math equal, and in the constructive interference, we get twice the electric field. That's a problem, because the energy goes as the square of the field intensity. So we may have twice the field, but we've got four times the energy. So we started off with unit energy on both sides, and end up with four times the unit energy on this interference. Well, the solution to that little puzzle is to look carefully what's happening to the magnetic field at the same time. When you have this constructive interference of the electric field, you have a destructive interference of the magnetic field. That magnetic field has the same energy as the electric field. So what's happening is this balance of electric and magnetic energy in the original wave, in a constructive interference, it all turns electric and becomes electrostatic. And in destructive interference, we end up conserving energy, which is a relief, because if we haven't, that would be a problem. And destructive interference, it's the same kind of thing. We have the two waves coming with the electric field in the opposite direction. The electric fields cancel out in destructive interference, but the magnetic field cancels out. So it's not that the electric energy vanishes with the field, it just turns into magnetic energy. And again, you know, the equal balance turns into purely magnetostatic in a destructive interference. So I looked at that and, oh, that's cool. And then I did kind of a double take. I'll get to the double take in a moment. More generally, I worked out, and you know, they'll yank my PhD card if I don't put at least some equations in this. I compressed them all into one slide. And I'll try to make it as painless as possible. There is a quantity that is called the impedance, which is the ratio of the electric to magnetic field strength. And there's a characteristic impedance of free space that depends on the magnetic permittivity and the electric permittivity. You take the square root of that. And you can normalize the real instantaneous, here are the intensities right now ratio, to this characteristic impedance that they're supposed to be if they're in free space, and get a normalized impedance. Well, Oliver Heaviside came up with the concept of this energy velocity. How fast is the electromagnetic energy moving? And that's basically the pointing vector divided by the energy, and I also divide by the speed of light to make it a normal or a unit magnitude, unit-free quantity. And that's kind of messy with the cross product, the vector products here, but if we substitute in the impedance, we get something pretty straightforward and simple. And if you do microwave theory, you'll notice that looks kind of like a transmission coefficient. Well, there's another quantity with which physicists are deeply enamored called the Lagrangian. And the Lagrangian is the difference in electric and magnetic energies. So if we normalize that according to the total energy, we get a quantity I call the normalized Lagrangian. It has some really cool properties. If you have radiation, balance equal amounts of electric and magnetic energy, that's going to be equal to zero. If it's electrostatic, all of the energy is electric, plus one. If it's magnetostatic, all the energy is magnetic, minus one. Now something really happens if we do just a little bit of math here. Suppose we take the normalized Lagrangian squared and add the normalized energy velocity squared. If you crank through the math, what you discover is that sum is equal to one. And that is the equation of a unit circle. So we can plot this out, and that's why I call this the great circle of electromagnetism. So if we have a forward wave, it's moving the speed of light, the normalized energy velocity is plus one, the normalized Lagrangian is zero. Let's suppose that wave interacts with an open, the energy goes electrostatic, it slows down to zero, and then turns around and goes in the opposite direction. If it interacts with a short, say on a transmission line, the energy becomes magnetostatic, turns around, and ends up going in the opposite direction. So you can plot all of these interactions of how waves interact, like on a transmission line or plane waves in free space, using this to understand how you can slow down from radiation to electrostatic. I mean, normally, when we teach electromagnetics, you've got radiation, we spend a lot of time talking about radiation. We spend a lot of time talking about electrostatics and magnetostatics, and all those arcs in between are on your field and when you're active, and we don't really need that. This connects them all together and shows how they work continuously. But then I realized, did kind of a double take, static, electrostatic, magnetostatic, you have electromagnetic waves. They're always moving at the speed of light. They don't slow down. So how can we end up with static energy? You can't have the energy slow down and then say, oh, there's my wave, and it's continued at the speed of light. Now I've got to catch up with it. You know, it can't go faster than the speed of light. That is not the solution. So what's happening is the energy slows down, stops, and changes direction. When you have two waves interfere, they trade energy one with the other. Let's take a simple case here. Suppose I have about the simplest wave you can imagine. It's got it goes down and it goes up. And there's a mirror image, goes up and goes down. And we're going to, we don't have a super conducting super collider here. So we're just going to take this transmission line, run these two waves into each other. The two goes up, well, we're going to plot it out of space-time diagram. Time is the vertical axis, space is the horizontal axis. So you've got these two waves coming in, 45 degrees, speed of light. The two goes up parts interfere with each other constructively and make an electrostatic node. Right at time equals zero, at t equals zero, they cross over, they exactly cancel out. They're mirror image waveforms. The electric field goes to zero. We have two magnetostatic nodes of energy. We start to pull them apart. The two goes down parts of the wave add up constructively. We have this last electrostatic node, and then the waves separate. So you'll notice the waves, they just pass through each other at the speed of light like nothing happened. But when they did that, they set up momentary nodes of electrostatic and magnetostatic energy, and they ended up creating energy. All the energy that was in the forward wave ends up in the reverse wave, and vice versa. Now, we can even do this looking at something like, say, sine waves running along transmission lines. We have equal and opposite sine waves, again, on a space-time diagram. We have a forward wave moving forward at the speed of light, a reverse wave going reverse at the speed of light. And if we look at the energy, they're equal and opposite waves. There's no average energy flow. But what's happening is the energy is oscillating back and forth. First it's pushed by the forward wave, then the reverse wave, then the forward wave, and so forth. Now, we can also look at the case of unequal waves. So let's have a big forward wave and a smaller reverse wave. And if we look at the energy flow there, now there is a net energy flow with a big forward wave, but it's still getting pushed back and forth in the interaction with the reverse wave. So the trajectories on the space-time diagram, they're completely different. The waves are always moving speed of light 45 degrees. The energy, it's following whatever crazy trajectory the superposition of the two waves happen to tell it to follow. Different trajectories, and you know, the punchline, not to spoil it, is different trajectories. They have to be different entities here. So the conventional view is that electromagnetics is only due to one entity, a photon, a one entity that combines the mutually contradictory properties of being a particle and a wave simultaneously at the same time. My view is electromagnetics has to be due to at least two entities, wave-like fields that guide the flow of energy that in the quantum limit is going to behave like a particle. It's really basically just the pilot wave theory of quantum mechanics that pops out of this classical electromagnetic analogy. Now, another way to approach this was taken by some German researchers, Wünscher, Hauptmann, and Hermann in 2002. And they took kind of a blank slate approach of how would energy flow if we're trying to take a look at some simple cases, simple diagrams like this. Well, we know energy flow lines have to begin on a source that emits the energy and end on some kind of an absorber that captures or absorbs the energy. If each surface isn't absorbing or emitting, then the energy flow line has to run parallel to that surface. If there's no absorption to draw the line in, no emission to push the line out, the energy flow has to be parallel to the surface. And the final principle is the notion that energy flow lines never cross. If you think about the, I can't tell this in the science fiction audience because you figure out who came up with that. You're my punchline.
Sorry, I apologize. It just hit me. I couldn't help it.
So, yes, named after the famed Columbia University paraphysicist who identified the fundamental physical principle, you can't cross the street. And I've gotten away with this. don't tell my reviewers. It's probably going to take a few more papers, but eventually that's going to be the official, and it's going to be like the Bagamizer. Anyway, the energy flow lines can't cross because it's described by a pointing vector. If you've got a vector, it can't point in two directions at the same place at the same time. I mean, if it is, you're talking about some different math that isn't the conventional pointing vector, vector math you'll notice the field lines, or the rays of this beam, crisscross each other. The energy flow lines, they don't cross. So they flow parallel to the ground in this interaction region. If you take a look, the energy that was associated with this, say, leading edge, ends up on the trailing edge. And the energy on the trailing edge ends up on the leading edge after reflection. It flip-flops what energy is associated with what field.
Cool.
Yeah. If you have two waves or two beams intersecting, a strong beam and a weak beam, the weaker beam energy accretes to the leading edge of the stronger beam. The stronger beam sheds energy to reconstitute the weaker beam after they interact. And you can even create some really wild cases. You set up two reflectors at 60 degrees here. You have a field energy flowing in, bouncing off the first reflector, bouncing off the second reflector, and then once you initially set up that energy flow there, from then on out, the fields may keep doing that triple bounce or double bounce, but the energy bounces off the interaction region and just continues straight on away. Well, that's kind of counterintuitive from the way most people think. Yes?
Bottom figure A. Is the energy then moving along the conductor at faster than the speed of light?
No, it is moving at the speed of light. You have to keep in mind, this is the steady state case. If it was, initially, what would happen is, the energy here is not going to get reflected off until after the fields have a chance to bounce off and catch up with it. So yeah, this is a steady state case. It's not showing the transient of how this gets set up in the first place. And that's where that would come into play. Any other questions?
Does the interaction between the two beams change with the wavelength of light?
Not really, no. I mean, you'll see similar kinds of interactions. I played around with simulations of different frequencies, and you see very similar kinds of behavior. But I'm going to run out of time if I don't speed through here. So let me zip through. What I did in a recent paper is I wanted to take those intuitive qualitative rules and analyze them using the numerical electromagnetic code that antenna engineers use to understand their antennas and how they work. So I modeled an 8x8 array. I used what's called Dolph Chebyshev weighting. So you can see how the elements in the center have a higher intensity, more power than the elements at the edge. That minimizes the side lobes, so I have a beam that's just pointing in one direction. The antenna pattern is about 16 degrees, really tight, side lobes down about 28 dBs. That's a good beam. It looks like this. You have a beam broadside of the array in both directions. I'm not going to worry about the goes backward beam. I'm just going to use this as my flashlight for studying some various problems here. First problem, let's take this beam, put it 10 wavelengths away from the origin at 30 degrees, and calculate the fields using that, and the energy flow streamlines look like this. You have the energy flow moving nice and uniformly in the main beam, a little bit of ripple from side lobe to main beam and so forth, but that's a pretty clear and coherent picture. Now let's put in the ground plane to reflect off of it. This is what the field solution looks like. You see, we're setting up a standing wave as the incident and reflected waves interfere with each other. The energy flow looks like this. That's a little messier than the cool conceptual diagram that Wünscher and his cohorts came up with. That pretty much lines up with what they were predicting. Now let's look at that 60 degree reflector case. So we set up the array parallel to a ground plane. I may put a whole bunch of wires close together to emulate the 60 degree inclined plane. So the fields are bouncing off that, off the ground, and propagating on up. And it's not quite as close. You can see there's obviously a vortex that looks like the energy is going missing in the middle of that vortex. Well, that's because this is really a 3D problem that we're looking at in 2D. The beam is spreading the further along you go. The beam is tighter, more intense as it's coming in. It's spreading out. So what's really happening is energy is being lost off of this plane. But qualitatively, it pretty much lines up what Wünscher is predicting. Now, a parabolic dish reflector. So we have an antenna at the focal point 2 wavelengths away. And you can see how the energy flow from the antenna moves parallel to the reflector, only then moves off into side lobes, and then all this energy, even the energy that started off kind of going down toward the reflector, ends up bending and being projected up into the main beam. Now this is a less practical, but probably more interesting case, a quarter section elliptical cylinder reflector. The semi-major axis is 5 lambda, the semi-minor is 4 lambda, follows kind of a Pythagorean theorem relationship, so the focal point is 3 lambda away from the origin, there's another focal point 3 lambda away, so from a ray tracing point of view, this is the kind of situation that we're expecting. When we look at it from an energy flow point of view, all the energy ends up flowing parallel to the reflector and then moving away. So even when we look at the fields, we see fields coming from the source and moving this direction. The energy they're carrying away actually started off going pretty much at a right angle and then flowing along the reflector. So you get all kinds of interesting divergences in the paths that you would expect for fields versus energy. Now, two equal beams intersecting each other, you get exactly what you predict. A plane here where the one of the fields goes to zero, the energy stops and bounces off. It's kind of like how you do image theory, if you're familiar with that. You know, in image theory, you've got a ground plane, you have a source on one side, you assume there's a mirror image source on the other side, and that creates the boundary conditions that the fields are going to zero on the plane. Well, suppose you don't have a plane, and you replace the plane with a real source instead of a virtual source. The same boundary conditions, the same physics, and the same energy reflecting off of that plane. That's basically what you're seeing here. Now, we can do unequal beams. You get pretty much the same kind of solution that Puncher was predicting. Now, these are two co-polarized arrays. Let's rotate 190 degrees, put it at orthogonal polarization. What you get is an even cleaner picture because you don't have a lot of interference taking place between the co-polarized fields. And if we make one of the beams a little weaker, same kind of picture. You know, in fact, very nice, neat example, almost exactly what Winscher and his cohort were predicting. So, I don't understand how you can explain results like this by assuming electromagnetics is one entity, a photon, and that somehow fields and energy always move together in lockstep. Fields guide energy. There's always an energy that's proportional to the field intensity squared, but the fields exchange energy from moment to moment as they interact. You have a balance of energy when it's moving at the speed of light, equal electric and magnetic. When you get into an interference, it's unbalanced, some of the energy slows down and changes direction. See, quantum mechanics interprets all of electromagnetics in terms of moments of emission and moments of absorption, and nothing happens in between, according to quantum mechanics. You have photons that just pass blithely through each other with nothing happening until they are either absorbed or re-emitted. But now the correspondence principle is the idea that quantum predictions have to reproduce classical results in the many-photon limit. That was a very useful idea. You're taking atomic spectra and using that classical physics to predict your quantum coefficients to make the equations work out. But you can't cherry pick, and that's cheating. So if quantum mechanics has to obey atomic spectral physics, it's got to obey standing waves interacting with each other in constructive and destructive interference physics. And quantum mechanics can't explain that kind of behavior unless, of course, you look at tidal waves. Now, if you go back to Dirac's principles of quantum mechanics, he has a very clear, very elegant explanation for why two photons can never interfere with each other. He says if you interfere with that, if you have two equal photons interfering with each other, you double the field, you get 4 times the energy, violates the conservation of energy, that's a no-go. If you have them interacting destructively, the field cancels out, the energy vanishes, you're not obeying conservation of energy, and that's a no-go. And he's forgetting that there's two fields involved, and that the energy is getting changed from electric to magnetic. But that's still a very commonly accepted concept in quantum mechanics. So, wave-particle duality. You have a balance of electric and magnetic energy. The reflections affect that balance. Quantum mechanics is basically arguing we get something for nothing. It's arguing that we get something, this classical interference behavior and standing waves, from nothing, this supposed non-interaction. And you go back to Parmenides, nothing comes from nothing. And that's violating very fundamental principles of physical science. You must modify quantum mechanics to correspond to that classical behavior. deBroglie had it right in 1968. He said, in cases kind of like this, you've got two lasers, a photon comes from one laser, it arrives in the interference zone, it is guided by the superposition of the two waves emitted by the two lasers. So if we take a look at two slits in an electromagnetic model, we see exactly the same kind trajectories. I couldn't get a model this big to run very easily. But qualitatively, it's very similar. This is a pilot wave quantum mechanical analysis of the problem. So if we start off with the two slits, we have fields propagating through the two slits, very intense at the slits, setting up an interference path. That interference pattern, in the classical case, guides the energy along this family of energy flow trajectories into the interference path. In the quantum case, we have a photon following a particular one of the set of trajectories that's been set up and ending up at the screen on the other side. So, it's kind of traditional to do a shameless plug, but I'm going to break the tradition a little bit to shamelessly plug other people's work. I'm running a book sale right now, about 160 books, a whole bunch of established and emerging talent. They're all 99 cents or free. You can go to my website, etherzar.com, and check out a huge selection of great books. Yes.
Your flag is excellent proof.
Thank you. But I wouldn't want to violate tradition too much, so I will plug my own book. The Hidden Truth is a book that is, I actually wrote it to kind of put my physics ideas out there. My starting concept was, that all these ideas I've come up with probably had to have been invented 100 years ago. So why hasn't anyone heard of them? Well, they've been suppressed by an evil conspiracy. And if you can get past your suspension of disbelief on concepts like that there's an evil cabal that's trying to rule the world and is deliberately driving the economy into ruin for purposes of their own so that they can take over, if you can get past that, you'll probably enjoy the story scenario. Yeah, if I'm not careful, I may have to reclassify this as nonfiction.
You need to stop creating training manuals.
Yeah, in book three, one of the bad guys ends up getting caught in sex trafficking to the Caribbean island and involuntarily commits suicide. About 6 months before that really happened.
Well, we were never here.
I've been working on the third book for several years, but I kind of set the fiction aside to work on the nonfiction book on fields and energies I'm going to talk about in just a moment. I had this really nice section, I really wish I'd got written, about how the protagonist is involved in election irregularities and fraud in Georgia. And it's probably a good thing that I didn't get that written beforehand, because if I'd thrown in and it was videotaped and they had video of them, pulling out ballots and running them through multiple times, no one would have believed it. I got a lot of new story material as opposed to better when it So if you want to learn more, if you want to learn more about the science, art and science of ultra wideband antennas, goes into a lot of the practical applications of it. If you're interested in diving into the physics, my transactions of the philosophic transactions of the Royal Society paper from 2018 on energy velocity and reactive fields goes into that a little more. And I'm coming out with a book this fall, Fields and Energy, How Electromagnetism and Quantum Mechanics Work, and Where Physics Went Wrong. And my contact information is here. You can email me, particularly if you're an author who wants to get involved in the sale, or if you want to get the release notes when the books come out, you can send me an email. I'll put you on my list. And with that, are there any questions? Yes.
We have pilot waves. What are they waved in?
Very good question. I don't know.
Have you rediscovered the ether?
Well, it's very interesting. You take a look at this. Really, the mindset that I approached this, when I wanted to understand electromagnetic energy, I read Hertz and Poynting and Lodge and all those late 19th century guys, and I really absorbed that ether-centric mindset. But when Michelson-Morley came around and quantum mechanics, people got really uncomfortable with that. Well, how can you have waves if there isn't something in which they are waving question. So they came up with a bunch of theories about ballistic photons and it's particles moving in a vacuum and the fields, well, that's just some kind of a mathematical construct that tells you which way they go. But, people talk about a vacuum, but it turns out we have vacuum permittivity, we have vacuum permeability, we have vacuum energy, we have all kinds of fascinating stuff happening in a vacuum. So for a nothingness, there's an awful lot of something that's going on in that empty space. What exactly? I refuse to offer any hypothesis. Well, it's kind of why I'm writing Fields and Energy. I mean, what happens is, I've been working on this for almost 10 years now, and discovered, thought, well, this is really cool. Everyone's going to be amazed. And very few people paid attention. And so I got my peer-reviewed article out. I mean, that's the imprimatur of real science. I got peers to agree with it and everything. But, there's so much peer-reviewed research out there. It's a drop in the ocean. The signal-to-noise ratio is very low, and it's very easy for people to not pay attention to stuff that's going out. So I was complaining about this to my friend, the science fiction grandmaster John C. Wright, and his similarly talented wife, L. Jaji Lamplighter Wright, about the trouble I was having getting this idea across. And they said, so what is this idea of yours? And I started talking, explaining it to them. About 5 or 10 minutes later, they're nodding their heads and saying, yeah, okay, that makes sense. And my jaw dropped, and the light bulb turned on, and I realized it's not that I have this amazingly subtle, complex theory that takes a supersized cranium and 2 PhDs to understand. It is actually pretty simple. But if you have, you tell someone that, when your professor told you that the little jiggling charge spits out a little point photon, professor told me that, and Jackson, why do you look at my head? It says the same thing. And, Sainted Feynman of blessed memory, you look at one of his diagrams, he's got the charge going, and then right there, wiggle, 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 wiggle goes the photon. Yeah. You can tell him, no, the Feynman diagram is kind of a mathematical bookkeeping trick. It's not physically real, but that doesn't really matter to them. So the reaction is, why? You're telling me everything I've ever learned is wrong. That is an extraordinary claim, and it requires extraordinary evidence. And I will listen sagely to what you have to say and nod my head. But then sadly, I'm afraid you have failed to uphold your burden of proof, and I am not convinced. So you lose, I win, and science triumphs. So what I realized is if you want to persuade someone of a simple idea, you express it in a simple way. And let high school students read the book. It'll be at a level of a good high school student or beginning college student should be able to have no trouble with. A lot of historical background. It's kind of fascinating how we went back and forth from wave theories to particle theories to wave theories to particle theories. How we had Aristotelian phases where people were doing experiments and measuring data and getting conclusions. Then more Platonic eras where people were making theories and systematizing and drawing the inferences, deductive versus inductive logic. And I tried to trace all that in the book. So I guess in short, if your student can wait until the fall, hopefully I'll have some material for you. Yes?
Your middle of the slide says quantum mechanics must be revised. Passive voice. Who are you nominating for that?
Well, I sure don't want to do it. I remember that guy. There's a reason I didn't go into quantum mechanics. I went into electromagnetics instead. So
what will this revision look like?
Pilot wave theory. I mean, basically, now, the issue, though, is it's not quite pilot wave theory. There's nothing in pilot wave theory, really, that talks about, two waves interfering with each other and, trading energy and bouncing off. It's kind of implicitly there, like where deBroglie was saying, you've got two beams, and the photon is guided by the beams. But you have to realize, if a photon is a quantized piece of electromagnetic wave energy, it's got a balance of energy. It's got equal electric and magnetic. But if it's in a standing wave, it's going to be like electrostatic or magnetostatic. And what is the frequency of a static field?
Zero.
And what is the energy of a quantum? Planck's constant times the frequency. So what I think is happening is the photons are coming together, and when you get into one of these electrostatic or magnetostatic superpositions, no longer quantized. It's going into a continuum of energy where if you want to think of it in terms of a quantum, the quantum size has to be infinitely small. And then after it does that condensation into this static electric or magnetostatic energy, then it has to re-separate into a balance of electric and magnetic and move away. But exactly how that works, I don't know.
If there's a true standing wave that's between two conductors and there's a certain separation, and that's forcing the quantization right there, isn't it?
Well, remember, if you go back and take a look at... this picture. It's not really static. If there are points here where it's momentarily static. Basically, the bright spots. It's all static. And then diagonally going between, it's moving. So it's condensing and separating, so forth. Isn't it time for me to stop? Oh, it is.
Yes, it is.
Did I miss the person with the stop sign?
Possibly. I'm not quite sure.
Okay. Well, I should probably conclude and clear the room for our next speaker. Thank you very much.